Fashion Week in Sydney was an absolute triumph. But it's a world away from the sisters' traditional home among the Kalkadun people of Mount Isa.
I'm the eldest. Then it's Dale, Glenda and Cheryl.
We might have... I wouldn't say they're arguments. We have disagreements. We have healthy debates.
We've come from a hectic household. We've created hectic households. There's 14 kids just amongst us four. And this is our normal?
The sisters' road to the runway started with a paintbrush inspired by country.
It's like nowhere else in the world. The beautiful red dirt and the beautiful rock faces and the spiky spinifex that's everywhere and the beautiful gum trees.
And the sunset out here is like orange and pink. And so we use a lot of those colours in all our paintings.
The fashion idea came from, I'm pretty sure, when we were like five and we've seen Mum sewing away on the sewing machine and we're like, we want to be designers or we want to make clothes.
Each dress is named after one of our aunties and we've got a silk dress made that's named after our mum. So each piece has a special place.
I've got the Rosie pants on. They're named after our Auntie Roz, and the Cindy box top is after Auntie Cindy.
And I've got a Lizzie dress. It's named after our Auntie Lizzie.
And I've got the sample piece.
Before they knew it, they were invited to Sydney Fashion Week by First Nations Fashion and Design.
They reached out to us and said, we're going to be a part of Australian Fashion Week. Shut your mouth. Nothing's official yet.
She started whipping up margaritas. That's what she did.
OK, I mixed up Malibu and pineapple juice in the thermo, mixed it like one in the afternoon and made everyone drink it, whoever was there, my dad, these girls. So we made margaritas and then it was back to reality, school run.
When the big day arrived, the reaction was overwhelming, with one reviewer declaring, the future of fashion is bold, black and bright.
That atmosphere was crazy. We couldn't believe we were there.
That was like, what the hell? Like
zero to 100.
Yeah.
Well, it's fantastic what they've done. You know, it's just incredible, you know. So when I think about the talent of her mother and that there, I think, yeah, I understand, you know, where they get the talent from, you know. Because she can do anything.
Next up, a feature in one of the world's most respected fashion magazines, Vogue.
Dad bought his first Vogue magazine ever. He was up in Bemigo working and he bought his first magazine for the plane ride home and he was showing all the ladies on the plane, this is my daughter's design.
I love my kids. I love my grandkids. Yeah, it's very important.
Hello, baby.
Hey.
I'll sing one, eh?
As the sun sets, Battle Mountain turns to gold.
We hope to inspire the next generation of Indigenous artists in whatever they want to do. Like, you can be a mum, you can live on country and do these things if you want to.
I'm super proud of being an Aboriginal and being able to, you know, tell my kids, like, be proud of who you are. There's no shame in that. You're beautiful. You're amazing.
You don't have to try and be a different person to fit into this world. You're an Aboriginal. Lift your head up high and, yeah, own that you're an Aboriginal in Australia.
And the Yammer.
Story, beautiful clothing. I'm intrigued to know from your point of view, Mitch, because we're obviously as a nation going on a big journey right now, wherever that is going to take us to. But part of that is this inclusion of language and culture and design and story, traditional stories and culture, into the centre of everything we do. How do you perceive it?
Oh, I think it's just beautiful. I mean, to see these sisters from Kalkadun be able to go and put their story, journey, culture, lore, and take it to the world in an authentic way, I think, so beautiful, especially in the past where we've had, you know, so many other people from overseas appropriate art, appropriate these things. I think for our people and mob to be able to take ownership back and to coincide with incredible people of all different aspects of the creative space to do something, to go to the world that is of quality, because I think our culture, it is, it's of a world class.
Because you started singing in language as well yourself, like taking pop songs we all know, John Farnham,
John
for example.
John Farnham, you're the worst.
But I'm kind of intrigued, though, because when we were chatting about it this afternoon, you said it's great seeing name changes, it's great seeing language being reintroduced or introduced more broadly, but you don't want that to happen instead of substantial change.
Yeah.
But I just wonder whether actually this is about everyone changing their attitude and perceptions a bit.
Yeah, we did have a great conversation this afternoon, but yeah, it is. I mean, I think it's great we're progressing, and it's great to see like buildings being named in local language, you know, acknowledgements of country being performed and that respect being there and acknowledgement. But I feel like we've got to still do the groundwork, and that is we're still overrepresented in all these horrific things. You know, we're the most highly incarcerated people on the planet. You know, we've got a high, absolutely overrepresented in suicide. The list goes on. And I think even from the perspective of out of all Indigenous people in the world, we've got the lowest life expectancy, yet we're in this beautiful first world country that's always on the cusp of cutting edge medical things, you know. So I feel like we've still got a way to go, but here we are, it's NAIDOC week and we're celebrating, and that's a beautiful thing too.
Get up, stand up, show up. Exactly. You got to show up.
Got to show up, got to stand up, and we've got to do it together, yeah. All of us.